had to cry today. Yeah. It's already written that today will be one to remember. Had to cry today. It's already written. Today will be one to remember. A day to remember for sure. Had to cry today getting up. Said, wow, still stuck in this world where we have to stay on top of all this hideous triviality and stuff. If we don't, we get buried. We got to call our insurance company. They claim, money. Can't get through. They're going to call us back. They don't. So waste all your time just trying to stay on top of all this nonsense. And then we... And you hear that Sweden is transitioning towards the idea of no cash, just apps, basically. Tight. It's like astonishing. I had to look at this because it's so depressing. But we don't want to. So we cry a little bit today, and we rejoice a little bit because tremendous progress continues, unabated progress. And we just have to carry that momentum with us into the day, in spite of the demoralizing that nobody's interested, essentially. If you're interested in this, pursuing ascension, you find that most of the world is oblivious to this and opposed to it. They want to cater to the personality. It's very depressing. That part of it, for sure. So what I'm trying to do is help us all through that despondency and depression, and keep on trucking through that as best we can here. It's a beautiful, beautiful high pressure system day here in California. We're on the road again, going places that we've never been. And we're driving past all these ladies walking their dogs, and all the dogs have clothing on them now. They're all dressed like children. Here, you know. Yeah. Not just the poodles. I mean, all the dogs now dressed up like children. And what's going on? Gotta stay on top of that one, right? So constantly changing laws, constantly changing technology. Now we're going to go towards a cashless society. That's the trend, right? That Sweden's setting this trend. And, you know, their goal is, they say, we're almost at this utopia. This is their goal, a utopia in this world. And that is so absurd that, I better not comment too much on it. They might take offense. But we have been pointing out the absurdity of that continuously. Here, continuously, and we need to continue to point it out. But we get bored of it, you know, because wow. But indeed, that is the perspective, collective perspective there, that they're aiming to create a utopia in this world, which ties in with, you know, worshiping whimsicality. So we have to be patient with ourselves here, because the world is so verklempt that, and it just doesn't come out of it either, does it? And yet we can do that. We can do it. We can say, if I want to engage with trying to create an imaginary mind, okay, a mind that's responsible for my imagination and not me, then I'm going to do that in a different life, not this one. I'm going to do that in a different life, not this one. I'll tackle that in a different life if I decide to do that. If I decide to keep trying to create a separate mind that's responsible for my pretense, responsible for my imagination, and responsible for my reactions, my pretend reactions. I'll tackle that in a future life, okay? If I decide to do that, but not in this life anymore. Not in this one. This is ascension. This is essentially ascension. This decision, this clarification. So one thing we can say to others is that, you know, they have to be able to recognize the mistakes they're making and work on them. They can't just robotically ask us to just continually forever keep pointing out their mistakes as if that's the correction. And this is what laziness does. It says, oh, you're going to preach to me? Okay, go ahead, but you have to keep preaching to me forever because I'm not going to take any responsibility. That's, of course, a personality reaction. That's saying, well, I'm the personal self. I'm this personality self. And so there's nothing I can do about it. But if you want to preach to the personality self, and maybe that'll keep the notion that there is a personality self. So this is not a mood of repentance. The mood of repentance means that we're listening with our spirit. We're taking this in with our spirit, and very few do that here. Very few do that here, right? And yet this is what we're called to do. We're all called to do this. Now, it's important to realize that the collective does not override our freedom. And so if the collective decides not to ascend, that does not in any way prevent us from ascending. And in no way does it make us wrong. See, taking a vote and saying, okay, the majority decide not to, doesn't make the vote, that decision, right. It doesn't make it right or wrong. It just simply doesn't preclude it doesn't preclude freedom at all. So if we take a vote and say we're not free, that does not preclude our freedom in the slightest bit. Not in the slightest bit. And so we wake up today and somebody's crying today, right? There's emergency vehicles going. So everywhere around the world, people are crying. Crying, feeling that there's some necessity to this world and bodies. No, it's whimsicality. Whimsicality is not a necessity for us. Freedom is a necessity, yes. The only necessity that we have is freedom. And of course we're claiming that we're making a mind that is not free. And that's necessary. So there are clarifications that we can see that help us, and we get to them. We get to them. But we have to kind of ease into them. Because certainly the world will not agree with these at all. So it requires a tremendous backbone and faith and determination to do this, for sure. Oh gosh, look at all these cars backed up. Oh my. Oh no. Gridlock. Gridlock. There's a guy with a dog, and the dog is not dressed up. Interesting. Dogs as substitute for children. Wow, this thing is just... Let me see if I can get through here. Gridlock. Fortunately, I'm going in the other direction, so there was no gridlock for me. So there's no gridlock for us. We don't have to stay on top of the effort to create a separate mind. We don't have to stay on top of that effort. If we do, if we want to get back on top, on trying to stay on top of that effort, we'll do it in a future life. Future life. So we're giving ourselves the option of a future life. Whereas many here say, no, we have to do it this life. We've got to create a separate mind this life. This is what this life is for. We say, no, I'm going to dedicate a future life to this if I decide to do it. This gives us a little mental space, doesn't it? And then we keep on, gives us some leverage. So we keep using that leverage. Use this leverage. Bodies are just a device that is being used to justify all this effort. I said, well, we're doing it for the body. All this materiality, trying to stay on top of it all. You distribute it all, pay for it all. So we're developing all these systems, frantically working all this. And the body's just an excuse. What if there were no bodies? Would we need to do all this stuff? And that's why we say, well, God made these bodies just to help us out, to help us out. Otherwise, we'd seem foolish, right? All for nothing. Well, guess what? Bodies are nothing, too. Yeah, they're nothing. Much ado. So there's much ado about nothing. Materiality, form, the belief in time, space, process, and form is the body's the hero because it seems to justify it. I say, well, we're doing it for the body. This is why the ego is, it doesn't like miracles. It's allergic to miracles. It says, no, you can't do that. You gotta have process. The body requires process. The body requires this. The body requires medicines. The body doesn't require anything. Everything, all the needs that the body has are projected upon the body by the mind, are imagined, whimsically imagined by the mind to be projected upon the body. So we're afraid of saints. We're afraid of a saint just appearing in front of us, a body. Say, a body can't do that. You can't do that. That's not allowed. That takes away our old justification for trying to create a separate mind. It's not fair. Oh, we can't succeed if we trust in miracles. Oh, now I am going into the gridlock. So someone just reminded me that I could go around it. Thank you. Thank you, thank you, thank you very much. Ha! Ah, beautiful. You see that? I was going to get stuck in it there because I wasn't paying attention. And the car in front of me decided, no, I'm going to go around this gridlock. And then that triggered in me the remembrance. Oh, yeah, that's what I want to do. So you see how talking about ascension can trigger in us the remembrance, like, oh yeah, that's what I really want to do. I want to ascend out of this madness, this realm that is using this body as an excuse for insanity, for an attempt to change reality, using the body as an excuse. And they insist that you use the body as an excuse too. So they insist that you be infirm, that you be sick, that you age, that you this and that, all this, all projections upon the body, all of them, all of it, all of it. And they ignore any proof to the contrary. I think the most proof I've ever seen is Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma. Without question, just non-stop parade of miracles, of miraculous functioning. And we ignore that. I tried to bring this to the attention of the world. Say, hey, everybody, look at this. Silence, ignoring it. Just, you know, complete like, what are you talking about? Crazy. We don't. And yet we have had the evidence here in the 20th century. For most of the 20th century, we had this evidence, powerful evidence, that the body's needs are merely projections. That's all it is. Incontrovertible evidence, and yet people simply ignore it. And they just say, wow, oh, she's a nice lady. She's a beautiful lady. Oh, look how she's so sweet. She looks so kind, you know. But was that the only purpose? To look like a nice lady? Really? And they say, oh, Ma, you're so, we love you so, Ma. Yeah. But, I mean, this appearance showed us so much of great importance. And the people they said, no, I don't want to look at that. She said, I don't need to eat. I don't even need to use the senses. I can see without the body at all. I don't even need the body to see. The lightness and darkness, like pitch dark night, so to her, she said, everything's as bright as daylight. I don't even use the bodies to see. This electromagnetic light has no, I don't use that to see. I don't use that to be aware. And it just on and on and on and on. Having her body completely full of cancer, to the point where the doctor said she's certain to die that night, it was so bad. And then wake up in the morning, it all vanishes instantly. And doctor said, completely gone, in an instant. And the doctor even witnessed this. And he said, well, that's not supposed to happen. We don't want that to happen. What do you mean? We don't want that to happen is the right response. Not that that can't happen. It says, we don't want that to happen. Uh-oh. Wow. Oh, okay. So this is gridlock. This is why they're doing road work here. So I bypassed it. You see that? They're doing maintenance on the ego, right? Staying on top, I got to stay on top of all the roads. Keep that in mind. Every single road in this world needs maintenance, and it's all crumbling and decaying. Is this the kind of world you want to live in? Every lawn needs maintenance, right? Every yard, every house, everything needs to be protected from decay. Is this the kind of realm you want to live in, that we want to live in? Talk about what we want. Let's talk about what we want. They said, but we don't want to see that the body is not really an excuse, good excuse. Well, how about what we want is we don't want to live in this realm of decay. How about that? How about that? This is almost golf weather today. We'll see. We'll see. Ah. How about that? We don't want. What do we really want? What we really. Yeah, but. What the people say here, the ego-driven minds, ego-driven purpose is, well, we can just maintain everything in a smart way. Really? Yeah, but aren't all the roads decaying? Isn't altered by a light of the sun, or the sun's rays? Isn't that, you know, desiccating everything slowly but surely? It breaks down mountains, breaks everything down, doesn't it? Yeah. Is this the realm we really want to live in? The realm of vulnerability, extreme vulnerability. Oh, climate, you know, the atmosphere, holding the ozone, this, rays, the sun rays give you cancer. Got to take medicines. Is this the realm we really want to live in? Or is it just an excuse we're using to pursue our search for an absence of totality? Is it just an excuse that we are imagining? This is the question we need to ask ourselves. So the day is starting off really well. Really, really well. Miracles already just abounding right now. I'm showing a picture from, let's see, 1976, I believe. Someone showed me a picture, their picture, with the long hair, the hippie look and everything. It was awesome. Brought back powerful memories. Powerful memories. Holy cow. Then I'm talking baseball with someone who really has the attitude. Understands it. And I said, you know, doesn't matter if it goes over the fence by a foot or by 40 feet, it's still gone. It's gone. And he said, yeah, that's right. That is the key. So, like ascension, it doesn't matter. Measurement doesn't matter. If you ascend, you ascend. It's not a measurement game. If you're out of here, you're out of here. Right? And let those, you know, there's no quibble about it. And of course, those who don't want that, the sour grape, they say, well, they only ascended just before, you know, they didn't ascend a little, you know, they ascended just before the troubles. They didn't ascend a long time before, so what kind of ascension is that? That's not very good ascension. You know? It doesn't work that way. Your home run's a home run. Whenever you do it. If it goes over the fence, it's too late to measure. Measurement doesn't matter. And you get all these measurement freaks right now, right? This is what we got. Statcast and then baseball has just got turned into a travesty. You have these tech nerds taking over baseball, which is just an abomination in my opinion. And a lot of opinions, a lot of people. We hate it. Statcast, everything is measured now. And they don't care whether, you know, the home, it's you know, ball speed, trajectory, you know, on and on, all this stuff. How far did it go exactly to the, you know, to the inch? And then they put it in the cruncher and the computers, and the computers then forecast what's supposed to happen in games. And this is, it's all like virtual reality to them. And pretty soon we won't even need to play the season. It'll already be decided by computers. Seriously. They want to replace umpires with technology. This is an abomination. Umpires are part of the game. They're part of the fabric of the game. The human element is part of the game. That's the essential element of the game. They want to remove the essential element of the game and just have it all be robots. So they're not even looking, is it a home run or not? They're looking at the stats and the measurement. But a home run is a home run. That's it. You trot around the bases. The run's on the board. That's all that counts. That's all that really counts, ultimately, right, in that game. And we're losing sight of even that. That's the madness that's going on in this world. It's an insidious madness, and you can certainly experience it as it creeps into baseball. I'm very keen about baseball, and I notice everything like that happens. I say, wow, that's a very bad development, very bad. And there's enormous pressure now on baseball to basically lose its soul. Basically lose its soul. That's what the pressure is all about. And this is pressure on all society to lose its soul, meaning its desire to recognize reality. Reality's still here. It hasn't gone anywhere. But we're just refusing to recognize it because we're searching for an absence of reality and thinking that there's a way to find it. If we just streamline the search, if we're just like Sweden and we streamline the search, let's just get rid of cash. That'll help us streamline our search. And we'll have a utopia. This is madness. This is folly. This is whimsicality. This is whimsicality, and whimsicality demands massive defense and imaginary justifications, which this body provides, and yet we fail to recognize that the body is merely a projection itself, and all the needs of the body are also projections, mental projections. And when we get evidence to the contrary, we ignore it. So what good does it do to have someone like Sri Sri Anandamayi come in here and fall down dead and start rotting? The body starts rotting in front of people's eyes, and then suddenly the body returns to a pristine, completely pristine state. Boom, like that. What good does that do? Only for those who are truly oriented towards salvation. The rest of us, what do? We just ignore it. Just ignore it. Because that takes away our justification for insanity. It takes away the necessity. We think, no, insanity is necessary. The body demands it. We think that the body demands this world. The body demands all this technology. Or the body-mind demands this. We've made up a mind that the body has a mind, and the body-mind demands it. The body mind doesn't demand anything. It's all a spiritual projection and a desire to try and change reality. And again, we ignore the incontrovertible evidence. We just ignore it. But it was brought to my attention. I didn't ignore it. I said, this is very important. And I tried to tell the world about how important this was, and they ignored it. Absolutely ignored it. I can tell you this. Spent a fortune. I mortgaged my future. I did everything I could possibly do to try and tell people, look, you've got to pay attention to this evidence. Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma gave more evidence than I have ever come across that the body is merely a projection, a spiritual projection, and all the needs are mere projections. Massive incontrovertible evidence. And we choose to play these little games on our smartphone, okay, and ignore the evidence and then call ourselves smart. How smart is it to ignore incontrovertible evidence? Now, I'm not lecturing anyone that's watching the video at all. I'm giving support to an attitude, that you can have this attitude also. Don't be afraid to see it this way. And I'm sure you're able to see it this way and said, yeah, but we're so pressured into going along with this hoax, really. This world's a hoax. And we say, but it's a necessary hoax. No, the necessity is the hoax. Yeah, but if I let go of it, there'll be an abyss. No, that's a hoax also, which just supports the idea of the necessity of it. We made that up too. The abyss is also a mental projection. Where does the abyss abide in? In pure spaciousness, of course. As a decoration of its own intrinsic spaciousness. An abyss is also just merely an appearance, merely decoration of its own intrinsic spaciousness. Just like all appearances. So, we need to have this attitude towards this notion of an abyss. The continuity fear says, well, there's an abyss. That's not all it says, but that's part of it. And we need to recognize this, right? I wonder if the dogs enjoy the clothing. Yeah. Nobody asked them, right? Yeah, so, watched a little basketball last night, watching Steph Curry, who's... He has really a transcendent skill set, like Michael Jordan did. He's in the same level of having a transcendent skill set, a skill set that transcends the game. It's just at a different level of everybody else. And, you know, it's fun to see that. But the surrounding commercials and everything, the personality cult of the world, it's just, I said, I can't watch this. Can't watch it. No. It's okay. I saw some of it, but I said, that's more than enough. And so that's how it is. So I don't, you know, completely boycott TV, but I might watch a couple minutes of Steph Curry. As they say, he's the most watchable athlete in the world right now, which is very true. Very true. And, you know, and that's it. So we're not like trying to crucify the personality. We're not trying to crucify anything. We're just trying to see it as it is. That's all. Just see it as it is. Alpha pure guru vision. That's all we're getting at. No condemnation of ourselves for whimsicality. Just seeing whimsicality for what it is. That's all. And we're just saying, okay, that was kind of intense, and now we're going to a reduced intensity zone. A reduced intensity zone of whimsicality, where our interest in it is a much greatly reduced intensity of interest in it. Okay? Arizona, a reduced intensity zone. Going to Arizona, a reduced intensity zone. Going to Arizona. Arizona. A reduced intensity zone. Going to Arizona. A reduced intensity zone. So we're not crucifying ourselves, not crucifying the world, not crucifying whimsicality, just reducing the intensity of our interest in it, the intensity of our curiosity. Our curiosity, a zone where our curiosity in whimsicality and delay, which is whimsicality, is greatly reduced. A reduced intensity zone. Ascend into a reduced intensity zone. That's all we're doing. Very reasonable, isn't it? Very reasonable. And since it's very reasonable, they're arguing with it is merely whimsical. And of course, defense of whimsicality is all sorts of plausible, you know, false logic and confusion. So that's just whimsicality. Right? Arguing with what is very reasonable is truly whimsicality. A reduced intensity zone. Just keep looking at it that way. That's very reasonable. We're just backing off our curiosity. We're just walking our curiosity back. That's all. We were curious about whimsicality and what it could do, and delay, which is part of curiosity. See, what will it do? We got to give it more time. Keep believing in time. We're walking that back because we decide, okay, not so curious about that anymore. So, what are we gonna do? We have to walk it back. So it's imminently and eminently reasonable. So I've just, amazing developments here. I've just been informed through the grapevine that I'm going to be forced in my job to use a smartphone. Now for me, the smartphone is the worst drug in the history of the planet. It's you can't even compare it to, you know, methamphetamine or heroin or anything else. It's a spiritual drug. It has extremely delays. It glamorizes delay, which is the worst influence possible. Okay, it's the worst influence that's ever been on this planet. The worst. And the Holy Spirit said, you got to stay away from it. And so I have been. So now I'm told I'm going to be forced into it. Well, I got to resign. I got to resign from my job then. So I don't have any income, don't have any savings, nothing. So it's a crisis, to say the least. You cannot compromise with when the Holy Spirit tells you something. You cannot compromise. You have to go with that because it has your best interests, and its job is to minimize delay, reduced intensity. Okay, of making effort to delay. That's its job. So, you know, Holy Spirit's on the clock right now. It's been on the clock my whole life, but never more so than now. And so I need another job is what I need. Or, yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. I need some income or some money right now. Right now. And so it'll be interesting to see how that goes. Fascinating, huh? And I mean, it's being put to the test. It's being put to the test. Demanding that someone use a smartphone is worse than demanding someone shoot themselves up with heroin. Way worse. And of course, that's an extreme crime, isn't it? An extreme crime. If you were to, you know, rape is way worse than rape. Way worse than rape. Saying demanding that someone use a smartphone is way worse than rape. Or gang rape is way worse. It is a gang rape, really. But it's way worse than that. Because everybody else is demanding it, right? So it's gang rape. And we put those people away for life, or if not, execute them, right? But here, nobody blinks an eye when a gang demands you use a smartphone. So it's amazing how stupid this world is, and the law supports stupidity here. The law supports stupidity, which it gets back to using the body as a plausible excuse for insanity. It's hilarious, isn't it? So, Holy Spirit's on the clock. There are no excuses that, you know, can be made whatsoever. It's inexcusable. You know, failure's inexcusable. It's inexcusable. That's the one thing that's inexcusable. So we will see what the Holy Spirit does. I don't have a clue. I really don't know what it's going to do. It doesn't put his cards on the table, really. So I can't say. I cannot. So I'm just in this limbo land right now. Limbo land. So, but I'll keep my attention open and see what happens here. So this is reporting live from planet Earth, you know, January 26th, 2016. This is what's happening. Gang rape is being not only tolerated, but encouraged by this world. That's how bad this world is. And actually, the crime's way worse than that. But it's being encouraged, and the laws support it entirely. Amazing. Now, of course, if nothing happens, then of course I would lose faith in the Holy Spirit. You can't help but that, you know, it's an unavoidable consequence, because you know you're told this is super, super important. This is the grace of God, and then if no help is given to avoid it, then you can't help but lose faith. So, but that's what the world is trying to do. It's trying to make you lose faith in the Holy Spirit. So this is just another example of the pressure of this world trying to lose faith. Now, I wouldn't lose faith completely. I don't want to test it out, but it would certainly be a bad blow. No question about it. You don't want that sort of stuff to happen right now. Right? It's very bad. Because this is key. As I said, it is the worst influence that's ever been on this planet, distracting us from our purpose here. It's distracting us, and that's the worst. The Holy Spirit's whole mission is to get our attention on our real purpose here and fulfill that purpose. That's its whole mission statement from God. So the smartphone is the worst distracting influence in history. So that has to be part of the Holy Spirit's mission, is to liberate us from the smartphone, liberate us from that. Drew the line, says that's enough of technology. You've had enough of it. You've seen what it's about. Don't hook yourself into it anymore, okay? Start to divorce yourself from it. Very important to start divorcing yourself from technology. But in the, you know, the situation that I'm in, I don't have any fallback. This is the issue, that they're pinned me down in a lot of ways. No question about it, that the ego is trying to, you know, nail my hide to the side of a barn door. That's what it does. That's what it does. So we'll see what the Holy Spirit does. This is like showdown at high noon here. I'm just kind of a spectator, actually. I've got to look at it that way. I got to look at it that way. I'm just, there's two gunslingers, you know, walking down the street at high noon here. I'm saying, okay, I'm willing to watch this, see what happens. And I can't lose my faith, because I will continue on, do the best I can in every way possible. Truth is still true, no matter what, how it seems at any moment. But certainly I'm enjoying this showdown at high noon here, and how this plays out. I've really been boxed in very badly. And yet, Sri Nandamayama said this is what she specializes in, is extricating you from the most extreme boxed in situations. She says she enjoys it. She loves it. She says, this is my functioning. I love to function this way. So again, that's the grace of God, Holy Spirit at work. And so I'm boxed in now. You know, they're getting ready to apply the coup de grace, and at least these two gunslingers, the Holy Spirit and the ego, are facing off here. Now, the Holy Spirit gave me another phone last night that we found in the closet, which is the precursor to the smartphone, which is not a smartphone. It functions very well. It's got a keyboard, actually. It's not touch. It's not a touch screen, which I don't like. I don't like touch screens. I don't do that. So it will work perfectly well for what I need, but no, you got to have a smartphone. It's an obsession with the world. It's a dangerous obsession, very dangerous obsession. I anyway, again, there's face-off at high noon right now. It's high noon, and the gunslingers are facing each other, and you know, their eyes are squinty, getting squinty. It's a very squinty time, a very squinty time right now. It's happening fast, too, so I got that heads up, and now, yeah, the executioner is about to strike, and what will the Holy Spirit do? Well, they gave me that phone yesterday. We'll see if that will head things off. Maybe that's it. And you cannot put commerce before spirit, you see. You cannot do that here. That's not our purpose here. If we do that, we're then negligent and irresponsible of our purpose. Commerce has to serve our spiritual purpose, not work against it. Okay, I have some poppies. I just saw already blooming. I think that's what I saw. And so, if we're negligent of our purpose, you cannot gang rape people to force them to serve your purpose, right? Isn't that forcing your will upon those who say no in terms of what we understand as right purpose? Okay? So right purpose is not forcing its will upon us. It's inherently so. It's inherently so. It's not an option. It's inherently right. It's the attempt to force irresponsibility on others, which is very bad. Very much counterindicated. So, what time is it? Well, it's almost noon, too, here. High noon. We'll see by noon what the Holy Spirit will do. It's a high noon time. So this drama beats anything on television. It really does. It's a spiritual drama we're talking about here, a genuine spiritual drama. And we all are in this drama together, actually. We're all in it together. Everyone has this spiritual drama working out in their awareness, in their attention. We all do. Every single one of us here on this planet has this intense drama working out in their play of attention. Now, I have people responsible. I'm responsible for people, for their welfare. I can't, you know, for me, I could just quit and disappear somewhere. Right? Just go to India or something, go wandering. I can't do that because I have, dependents that are not well, which is another box, you see. So I've been boxed in from every angle, seemingly every angle. Maybe the Holy Spirit has an angle that I haven't been boxed in. Yeah, and the Holy Spirit knows all angles. Keep that in mind. All angles. Even ones the ego cannot even imagine. And of course, ego gets furious. Oh, I wasn't smart enough to see that angle. How come I'm not? I'm stupid. I'm furious, you know. It projects the fury and attacks somebody. How come I was outfoxed there? But yeah, that's the price you pay for following the ego's advice. Is you feel that futility keeps showing its face. Every day we look in the mirror and what stares back at us is futility. Had to cry today. That's why I started out the day, right? Had to cry today. It's already written that today will be one to remember. Had to cry today. I sing lousy to drive the ego nuts. The ego says, you can sing so much better. What's the matter with you? How come you're not using the potential of your body? How can, you know, like that. I once sang George Jones off a bar stool. Once, I did. So, I don't have anything to prove singing-wise. I can sing terrible if I want to. And that's just to rile the ego up, you know. The ego gets upset about that. Anyway, I started the day. It's already written. Today will be a day to remember. Wow, that's how I started off the day, wasn't it? And already, it is already a day to remember. It's high noon. Already it's high noon. Good, it's time. It's time for it to be high noon here. It's time for it to be high noon. well, let's see if higher wisdom backs me up, or maybe, you know, maybe I'm just crazy. Smartphones are the best thing that's ever happened, and everybody should be doing it. And, you know, no. No. No, no, and no. I don't want to turn in, I don't want to be a citizen of Sweden, that's for sure. And that's where it's going, folks. It's all about the cashless society. It's all about streamlining the search. It's all about trying to make a utopia in this world, which totally, totally is the egoic path. It's totally irresponsible. It's avoiding our purpose here to see through the charade of time, space, process, and form entirely, that there's no truth to it whatsoever, not an iota of truth to it, never has been. There is no absence of totality whatsoever. To claim there's even the tiniest bit is the ego. That's what the ego is. And so we're claiming the utopia. Said, well, yeah, there's a little obstruction, there's a little absence, but we're learning to live with that. That is the depths of self-delusion. That is what we must overcome, this delusion. That's it. That is the delusion. And they say, no, just a little bit. So people think there's a lot that are deluded. No, the ones that think they're a little bit are the most deluded, because they think they're righteous. The righteous are the most deluded in terms of egoic righteousness, as Jesus pointed out very clearly. The Pharisees and the Sadducees, these very righteous, he said, those are the worst. Those are the ones who don't get into the kingdom of heaven. Because they're saying, no, we're only doing a little bit of sin, right? We're only sinning against God a little bit, and we're atoning for it. Jesus says, no, you can't sin against God. You cannot obstruct totality. You cannot have something abiding that's not abiding in pure spaciousness. There is no exception to this whatsoever. This is the gospel. And there's nothing else that's the gospel. There's nothing else that's the gospel. There isn't some other gospel. You can say it in a million different ways, but the message is exactly the same. It's exactly the same. Rana Maharshi, Sri Sri Nandamayama, Longchenpa, Jesus, Buddha, Shankara, you name it. They're all saying, what they're saying is exactly the same. Different styles, different emphasis, maybe different labels, different words. What they're pointing to is exactly the same gospel. Pure ecumenicalism, okay. Pure universal teaching. There is no exception to truth. That's all it is. There is no exception to truth. All truth is 100% true. All light is 100% light. There is not any exception whatsoever. And any belief that there's an exception is nothing but sheer arrogance. And the path of trying to minimize the exception is sheer arrogance and self-delusion. To say, let's just make a little exception. It's not a big one, so that's a smart thing to do, right? Come on, everybody, let's make a little exception, and then that'll be good. No, that is exactly what we need to target in terms of overcoming that delusion. That is the delusion we have to overcome and see through it. Nothing else. That is it. It's crystal clear. Very easy to point this out. So I'm ready for something else. I've geared up for it. I'm ready. I just say, well, when's it going to come? Well, only the Holy Spirit knows the timing of everything. You know, so I can't give up. I mean, the Holy Spirit knows the timing perfectly. I don't. But, you know, I mean, you don't want to wait until someone's just, you know, lost all hope and is despondent. That's... You know, it's probably not a good idea, you would say. You know, there's only so much stress we can take tearing our hair out here. If you see the bad path and you're being, you know, going down that bad path and you feel that you can't reverse it, well, that's real despondency. So, you know, it's again, we're just preaching the gospel here as best we can, and we'll try to continue to do that. We'll do that. Not even try to do it, we will do it. For what it's worth, here in this realm, in this realm of sheer arrogance. And so just getting additional clarification. I call this planet rape, because that's what it really is. I'm seeing this very clearly. I did this video saying that Mother Goddess is a rapist. She absolutely is. She's the one that is promoting and seducing and making it seem attractive, making rape seem attractive. To force an ideology of spiritual irresponsibility and delay, to believe that that's right and just, that's the attitude of a rapist, plain and simple. And I'm saying, wow, this whole planet is a rapist planet. That's all it is. So seeing that, wouldn't we want to ascend out of such a planet? Doesn't this then justify ascension? It sure does, doesn't it? So we're using stronger language now because it's necessary, because it's true. It's true. And it doesn't matter. I realize, well, maybe I can make a deal and try to, you know, plead for some help. And say, well, we'll give you a little extension. That doesn't matter. It's the attitude of a rapist. It's like a woman saying, well, please don't rape me. Please don't rape me. Say, well, okay, we'll let you off this time. But next time, you know, right? They're still looking for the opportunity, right? Maybe later. That the attitude is still there. So it doesn't matter if you try to make a bargain to buy a little more time for the execution, right? It doesn't matter. It's the attitude. Who wants to hang out with rapists, for instance? Who wants to hang out with rapists? I don't. This is what we're doing here in this world. We're hanging out with rapists, plain and simple. Actually, it's way worse than that. Again, that's a very mild term to use, but it's an attention getter, isn't it? Gets people's attention. Wow. Way worse than that. Trying to force insanity upon us. That's worse. It's like we're on the edge of a cliff. They're trying to push us off the cliff. And they're all falling. And they want you to fall too, into a dead end. So they feel better about their falling into a dead end. Say, oh, everybody's doing it. It can't be bad. That's what I said. I said, look, you're conformist. You're trying to force conformity upon me. Trying to force conformity upon me. And these all these very, you know, liberal people, oh, we're so tolerant liberal. No, they're rapists, plain and simple. They're trying to force conformity, their conformity upon us. Whereas spiritual freedom isn't forced upon us. We are that. We are created that. So you cannot, it's apples and oranges. You can't compare the two. You can't make that spurious argument, well, you're trying to force responsibility upon us. No, we inherently have the responsibility of our freedom. There's no way around it. It's inherent, and it's good, and it's just, inherently so. So they try to, you know, be smart asses about it. And they're not. They're just fools. Rapists, plain and simple. So, great. This is helping clarify everything here. You know, it's nothing like a brisk aftershave, you know, to like, wake you up and say, that's good, I just had a nice shave. Stings a little bit, right? Holy cow. What a bunch of slimy rapists this world is inhabited by. And hanging out with them has been just a hideous experience, actually. They don't want to change their ways. They just want to streamline it. Streamline the rape. And we'll call it good. Make it an assembly line. Let's everybody do it. And that'll be okay. This is this hideous conformity that has crept into the situation. So we can call upon Sri Sri Anandamayi. Maybe she'll respond to that. Putting in the terms of rape, maybe she'll say, you know, so being quote unquote a woman appearance, if they want to look at that way, says, you know what? I can certainly relate to putting it in that way. Now, this is just a, you know, humorous way of putting it, but I mean, gosh, you know, it's true. So anybody wants to protect from rape, it would be like a female guru, right? Absolutely. Of course, anyone would, right? Anyone would. So we're just having a little bit of levity, but of course, anyone would want to protect the idea of trying to force us into insanity, force us into a dead end. And this attitude is, you know, global, and all political leaders subscribe to it. The whole planet subscribes to it. It's planet rape, inhabited by nothing but rapists, severe, vicious rapists. This is this planet, actually. And all these people say, oh, love your mother, such a wonderful place. Really? inhabited by lovely people. Really? No, they're all going along with it. It's just like the enablers of rapists, right? They say, "Well, I didn't do it." No, you didn't. You didn't try to stop it. You condone it. Enablers. They're all enablers. And this is what I realized. You know, the people, that's what they are. So this is like an awakening, just saying, wow, this is how I really feel about it. I don't want to hang out with them anymore. So again, every day is a new normal, right? So we establish a new normal. This is the new normal now. This awareness is the new normal. This new language is the new normal. It's stronger language. We need stronger language to help wake us up and help us commit. And those who try to make us comfortable with a so-called compromise, which is just delay, so we won't rape you now, we'll rape you later, they're the worst. They're the worst. They're the ones who cleverly and speciously push it on down the road, saying, "Oh, okay, you caught us this time, but we'll streamline it and you won't be able to catch us next time once we streamline it." So they said, "Give us some time and think about this." What do they do? How they use the time? To try and streamline rape is what they did. That's what they did. Instead of getting with the spiritual path, being responsible, they used all their time and effort to streamline rape. Okay, so it's like, well, look, it's so streamlined. You got to honor that, don't you? You got to honor our creativity. We've been so clever in streamlining it. That's how they use their time here. Instead, so they said, no, we'll use our time to educate ourselves so we'll be able to understand what you have to say. They didn't use their time that way. They used it to streamline rape is the way they used their time here. This is the truth. Just like that priest said, it's time to speak the truth to people here. God bless him. I've shaken his hand several times, talked to him, and he's a very, he has some interesting qualities, to say the least. He's willing to speak from his heart, you know, really, to people. And he said, look, you may not like it, but I'm telling you. Well, I'm using much stronger language, to say the least. He may not go that far, but I can tell it's in him, you know, it's in him. Very genius type of mind, really. Very humorous person, too. He's able to put in a very great sense of humor. So that's a blessing. And so this is the new normal. We have to use this tough language, you know, to point it out. We're pointing out something, an atrocity. Okay, we're pointing out a global genocide. Spiritual genocide is happening on this planet right now. Spiritual genocide. And again, that's very mild terms. Spiritual rape. Everyone on the planet's being raped, and it's in genocide. Spiritual genocide. Use that term. This is literally what's happening here. Literally. And you don't want to be an enabler. You don't want to just turn the other way and say, well, you know, it's whatever. I don't know what to do about it. Blah, blah. That's nonsense. Ascend. Say, I don't want to participate in this. We can't stop it. We can't force them to stop it, can we? Because they say, you're forcing us against our will. No, but we can ascend and say, I'm going to wash my hands of this. I'm not going to have anything to do with it. I'm not going to try and, you know, destroy my freedom. Deny freedom to everyone, to one mind. We're all one, so denying freedom to myself is denying freedom to everybody else. It's an attempt to deny freedom to everyone else. And keep in mind that deals don't matter, again. To a rapist, say, well, okay, they say, well, I won't do it now, but maybe later, you know. What good is that? What good is that? I'm not going to make a deal like that, right? Who makes a deal like that? What's wrong is wrong. It's wrong now. It's wrong later. It's wrong this very instant in perpetuity. There's no point where it becomes right. There's no point in now. There's no now where time begins. So, what time is it? Well, it's about noon. So, I said it by high noon, it's 11:59:44:45. And I said, you got a response here by noon. You know, we got to get going on this. This is nothing to trifle with here. It's nothing to trifle with. There's no deals that can be made. Their attitude has been revealed. The attitude of the world has been revealed. High noon just happened. Okay. We'll see what takes place next. You don't make deals with the devil, plain and simple. You don't trifle with it. And I'm sure the Holy Spirit knows this, and it's just trying to wake me up to realize it. And I am realizing it. Wow, this is the new normal. This awareness is the new normal. So by high noon, here I have this new normal, which is stronger language. And, you know, I said, well, you've had 48 years to get ready for this language. You said you would get ready. And maybe you lied. Maybe you lied. Instead, we're trying to convince me to drop it by streamlining it, you know, streamline the rape and say, okay, well, look, you're so sophisticated, you should go along with it. Aren't you impressed by our sophistication? Maybe that's what everybody has done. It sure looks like it is, doesn't it? So this type of adamant talk is necessary now, in my opinion, and I'm capable of doing it, provided the right circumstances. The Holy Spirit provides right circumstances to help out. I cannot be under the gun, you know. It doesn't work that way. Under the financial gun, right? Healthcare gun. I cannot be under that gun. Any of the bodhisattvas can help out. There's no question. Wow, very, very intense. I'm just enjoying the intensity of this to a certain extent. It's like a bomb has been dropped, you know. Some terrible, terrible destructivity has been dropped. And you're saying, okay, what do we do to that? We see their intent now. Of the world. Not pinpointing or highlighting anybody at all. It's the overall perspective, isn't it? So this is a very intense wow. And this is the new normal. Getting used to this wow is the new normal. Getting used to this intensity is the new normal. So we say, yeah, of course. I can accept this. It's mild. What are you guys talking about? It's mild. It's like you get used to the weather in the hot desert, for instance, and it's 110. And you say, it's mild. Going out today, going to do some running. It's no problem at all. It's the new normal. It's like acclimatization. Now, you might say, well, isn't it the responsibility of the woman, for instance, to avoid the rape? Of course it is. However, here we have the situation with continuity fear, severe continuity fear. That's why there's the Holy Spirit. So you have to factor those factors in also, okay? When it comes to a spiritual issue such as ascension, for instance, well, they say, well, why don't you just ascend off the world then if you don't like it? Yeah, well, I will, but the continuity fear delays it a bit, you see. So we have to have compassion here for those on the spiritual path. That's why forgiveness and compassion is so important. I don't blame people who claim victimization and say they're wrong. Certainly, they were responsible for their experiencing, but I understand that continuity fear and valuing time brought made them decide to delay in this way. So I forgive them and say, look, repent. Jesus said, go sin no more. I forgive you. You're forgiven for sure. Go sin no more. Like that. In other words, come on, work on your continuity fear. So you can't just cavalierly say, well, if you don't like it, why don't you get out of here? Why don't you ascend? Well, yeah, why doesn't everybody ascend? I could just shoot it back at them and say, why don't you ascend too? Right? So why do we all ascend? Because of you know, continuity fear, lack of fear, familiarity with this. You know, we haven't done this before. And a lot of factors there that have to be worked through intelligently, bring into full consciousness and be aware of it, work it through. But the issue is, how have people used the last like 48 years that I gave them? They said, oh, be quiet. I said, well, when am I going to speak up then? Well, give us time. We got to adjust to it and get ready for it. Did they get ready for it by being spiritually literate? Or did they get ready for it by trying to bluff me and intimidate me? Intimidate any words of here that are spoken in truth. See, that's the question. And I think we probably know the answer already to that. So again, we are, the Holy Spirit's on the clock here, big time. And I will just keep on speaking truth here, best I can. But at this point, the truth that needs to be spoken cannot be openly spoken in families, right? There has to be some freedom for those who are speaking truth here in this world, from families, from those who would stifle them and say, well, that's not, we're captive audience. You can't speak that way to us. We have to, you know, do mundane day-to-day communications. And if we're afraid that you might speak this way, we get nervous and can't function around you. So that's not fair at all to be in a situation where you're part of a captive audience like this. It's not fair at all. It's not right. It's not effective. It's ineffective. But the time is of them saying, well, we need more time. No, you had 48 years. And I said there'd be a time when it would have to, then we'd have to start engaging with this. And the time has come. So just as they said, well, give us some time, I also said, okay, but you only have so much time. You don't have an open book time. There's a point where that, you know, delay or that has to come to an end. We got to start then get down to business. And that time has come. We have to get down to business now. Got to get down to business. Business of ascension. And so we will now see who can get down to business. And if we want to use stronger terminology, we would say there's a spiritual holocaust taking place and the world is nothing but a bunch of Nazis. Okay? And this is also accurate. We simply live in a world that is infested with Nazis and they're bringing about a spiritual holocaust. Now, what is this holocaust? Delay. The only thing that spirit can seem to be touched by is delay. It doesn't change spirit, but it gives the impression that spirit can be changed and has been changed or is being changed. And that's terrifying to spirit. Absolutely terrifying. So that's the worst that spirit can go through, is the belief that it can be changed, that reality can be changed. And delay is exactly that belief. We're delaying within this belief. So it's torture, hideous torture. Now, the Holocaust, the Jewish Holocaust, it wasn't just the Jews, but there was a lot of involved. But that Holocaust, World War II, for instance, we say, you know, that was just the worst ever. Well, this now, see, that affected the body. Okay. Not so much the spirit. This now is infinitely worse because it's a spiritual Holocaust that's taking place in this world. It is a spiritual Holocaust. And just like in World War II, somebody did not speak up. Right? Until it was too late. Same thing is happening now, except less are speaking up. Enablers, turn the other way, because they think, well, maybe this will benefit me, you know, right? Or I'm lazy. I'm too scared, I can't speak up. Well, then been lazy. That's the best that can be said. Very lazy, irresponsible and lazy. And so we have to repent and say, wow, Well, it's time to get down to business then. I can't remain lazy. That's an atrocity. It's an atrocity. What's taking place in this world is the biggest atrocity in history. A spiritual holocaust is taking place here. Right now. Right under our eyes. Right under our noses. The factories, you know, the cremation factory, the gas factories are everywhere, right? They're in our homes with our television and movies and smartphones and all of this. That's a spiritual holocaust. Who wants to be party to that? You know, why don't we ascend off this holocaust planet? This genocidal, rapist, holocaust planet. Because that's what it is. Why don't we ascend to a much better realm? A reduced intensity zone. We're not being forced into complete absence of the value of time. Okay, but a reduced intensity realm. Arizonaville. A reduced intensity realm. That's the only responsible thing to do, really. If you look at it in the right way, it's the only responsible action to take. Migrate. Like the Jews, get out of Europe. Get out of Europe. Migrate. Migrate to another realm. Now is the time to migrate to another realm. We knew that was coming, right? Well, it's here now. It's here now. Time to migrate to another realm. Plain and simple. And we can go stronger. We can say to all the bodhisattvas and the Holy Spirit, you're all on the clock right now. You are all on the clock without any exception. Every single one of you is on the clock right now, so to speak, to challenge your responsibility. Your responsibility and clarity is being challenged right now. Every single one of you. No exceptions. Look at it that way. No wiggle room, no delay, no exceptions. You're under the gun too. You're under the gun too. The challenge is upon you. So we'll see who has the right stuff here. Who has the capability to step up at this point, right? Not that that's a put down of the ones that don't, but this is a challenge, right? And a bodhisattva relishes the challenge. That's what Holy Spirit's all about. Maybe they can all work in concert. Someone might be the face of it, right? Migration, you have these underground railroads, right, that smuggle people out of the problem area. So there's a lot of involvement by many, and some are the face of it. They take generalship, you know, of it. So let's challenge all the bodhisattvas this instant. I certainly have just done so. All the saints and sages, ascended ones and blessed ones, the bodhisattvas, etc., they're all now officially challenged. The gauntlet has been thrown down. Let's see who picks it up. Let's see who picks it up. Let's keep in mind that smartness in the service of disguising insanity, disguising futility, is not smartness. Camouflaging futility is not smartness. It's not smart. It's not wise. It's stupidity. And this is what we're doing. This is what the world has been doing, is doing, is trending to continue to do. The trends are overwhelmingly that way, despite trying to spiritualize the stupidity. Camouflaging futility is not smart. It's not wise. It's stupid. And the thing is this technology is too much trouble. Sidestep too much trouble. You have to understand our limitations because of our continuity fear. We need to sidestep too much trouble. And the glamorization of camouflaging futility is too much trouble for us. And let these miscreants, these stragglers, these people who popularized technology, you know, the big shots, those are miscreants. Those are severe stragglers. Retarded, very retarded. And we have pity and compassion for them, but we also have to sidestep the intensity that they're bringing. They're, you know, intensely trying to disguise futility, and that needs to be sidestepped. That's too much trouble for us to deal with right now. We'll deal with that later on in a future life, okay? We'll deal with these miscreants in a future life, if necessary, if necessary. Perfect deal, huh? We will deal with these miscreants, these stragglers, in a future life, but not in this life. Not in this life. We've had enough for now. Okay? Simple. So this glamorization, and which is the camouflaging of delay, of futility, is too much trouble for us. Too much trouble for us. So we can absolutely decide we'll tackle that trouble in a future life if we should decide to do so. We don't have to decide to do so. If we should choose to tackle this trouble out of compassion, then we will do that in a future life. Right now, it's in the category of too much trouble for us. Now, there might be some in this world who say, well, it's not too much trouble for me. Well, knock yourself out then, if that's the case. For me, it's too much trouble. You would have to be perfect, you know, a perfect spiritual master to deal with this kind of stuff, really. The highest type of bodhisattva. I'm not there yet, okay? So for me, it's too much trouble. Now, if there's some perfect bodhisattvas here who want to do their thing, that's fine. Wonderful. I'm not that. So again, I'll tackle that in some future life if necessary. And meanwhile, for this life, I'm going to be free of it. I'm going to sidestep it. That's just, you know, ABC, black and white, very simple. That's ascension. That's an ascension, essential ascension decision. The essential ascension decision. The essential ascension decision. I'll tackle this too much trouble, this glamorization of futility. I'll tackle that in a future life if I should choose to engage with it at that time. But not this life. Not this life. So, I don't know what else to say except to keep repeating this. Perfect alpha pure guru vision for everyone right here, right now. Ascension attitude, essential ascension attitude right here, right now. That says it all. And again, the camouflaging of futility is stupid. And there's some who are trying to glamorize stupidity. And they've kind of hooked a lot of us on that glamorization of stupidity. You know, classical Christianity would call it Luciferian or satanic. And there are those satanic forces here in the world trying to glamorize futility. Trying to hook us on futility. We just say they're stragglers. Who are just enamored with their own arrogance. Still enamored with their arrogance. A lot of us have decided, you know what, that's not so much fun after all. So, for us, it's too much trouble. For the perfect bodhisattvas and saints and sages, maybe it's not too much trouble for them. I don't know. They'll have to speak for themselves. But for me, it's too much trouble. I'm speaking for myself. Way too much trouble. Way too much trouble. Sidestep too much trouble. Take refuge from too much trouble in ascension. Take refuge from too much trouble in ascension. If you choose to engage with this and out of compassion, do it in a future life, okay? When you're capable of doing it. If All right? When you feel you're capable, truly capable of being truly compassionate without getting yourself dragged down into it, which is, again, you can be compassionate not only to others, but to yourself, too, then you can do it then, but not in this life. Not in this life. Not right now. Not right now. Now, I did see in that dream when the storm was hitting, and I was getting hit by it, I said, uh-oh, this is trouble. Someone just miraculously placed this tabletop over me and that protected me. I don't know who did it and where it came from. It was like some sort of, a dwelling place, so to speak. A roof over my head. It was a roof, like a roof over my head, a black and white, like, tabletop, granite tabletop or something like that. And I didn't see who put it there. It just appeared. It just appeared. It was just placed over my head to protect me. It's like in that dream, I realized this storm is too much trouble. It's too much. Got to be protected from this storm. The storm of glamorizing futility right now is too much for us. It's too much for everyone here, I would say. Except maybe the top bodhisattvas, and again, let them speak for themselves. Maybe it's even too much trouble for them. I don't know. Maybe, right? But I would say it's a fair assessment. It's too much trouble for all of us here. Most certainly, in my assessment of everyone here, way too much trouble. So certainly, we are more than justified to sidestep too much trouble. And again, we'll engage with that in a future life if necessary. If the stragglers continue to straggle, okay? If they continue to try and glamorize futility, we'll deal with that in a future life. If that's what they want to keep on doing, I don't know. I'm open to the idea that maybe they'll decide it's not so much fun after all. But the more they hook people, more of us they hook into it, the more fun it is for them. At least it seems temporarily so. They say, wow, look how powerful I am. Wow, how smart I am. This is great. Everybody's fallen for my pretense. And it just feeds their arrogance. You don't want to feed the arrogance of the stragglers. That's bad for them. Very bad. So it's very nice to speak this way, and unfortunately I'm put under the gun to do this, but that's what happened. That's what happened. So it does provide a push to speak clearly and directly. But that's what we need right now, is we need someone who cuts through all the nonsense and speaks clearly and directly here to the problem, to the situation. We don't have time to be all circuitous at this point. Which is why Longchenpa was very helpful to me in presenting a teaching that just got right to the point and only the point. No circuitousness to it whatsoever. That's been extremely helpful. I'm very grateful for that. But we're at a juncture right now where we need some additional boost at this point. And this right to the point directness needs to become pragmatic for us to actually sidestep this camouflaging, this glamorizing, this camouflaging of futility. So we'll see who picks up the baton. I don't know. We'll see who's going to help us run this leg of the race. Looking forward to it. But I'm looking forward to it right now. We're certainly in a race against this glamorizing of futility, this too much trouble. We are most certainly in a race with that. And so it has to be a timely deliverance from that. Sidestepping too much trouble has to be in a timely manner. You cannot delay that. too much trouble will bury you if it gets to you. Just like I saw that crazy lady walking down the sidewalk yelling at me, and I realized that she was considering coming and engaging with me and trying to pull me into her insanity. And I took refuge in the store. I hid in the store, safe harbor. And I had to decide right away, what am I going to do? I had to make a decision. I had to be timely. And so sometimes it's good to have a proper rant. It's certainly justified right now. It is absolutely justified to have this very clear rant. Okay. It opens up a door. It's a new normal. It's a new normal. We're waking up. We're taking ourselves off mute. I put myself on mute when I was about 12 years old because the world says, wow, we got to catch up to what you're saying. So please put yourself on mute. So I've been muted for about 48 years. That's right. I've been on mute for 48 years. I've been practicing coming off of mute through these tapings, practicing coming off of mute, warming up to it, right? It's difficult to come off of it all at once, so to speak, if you haven't at least prepared to come off of mute. You got to regain your voice, which is just, you know, channeling, speaking the truth, sharing the urgency here. So I've certainly said quite a bit. I'm not going to try to remember what I said as far as like pick up the thread going forward. I just have been speaking from adamant clarity and urgency. And again, we'll see what happens next. Take it one step at a time here.